mission cannot just mainly be about anything. The mission entrusted to his followers is very, very specific. To proclaim the gospel to all people, to go to all the world. It took us such a long time to realize that we have redefined mission. For a long time, we have been saying mission is plantatio ecclesiae, to plant the church. We became ecclesiocentric. And it is one of the new awareness returning back to the sources, allowing scripture once more to guide us, that it is the kingdom of God we proclaim, the reign of God, the plan of God. My dear brothers, it is only when we go back to the original mission and the way it was carried out already from the beginning that we can, so to say, approach the title of this teacher. And what is it? Enjoying the joy of the gospel by having a church in dialogue. Bishop Joseph made it so clear to us that using even the words of Archbishop Sofiegas, that a problem definitely in the church cannot just be in terms of the number of priests, but rather whatever may be the number of our priests, vital is the zeal, the attitude, their own experience of faith, their own relationship with God. In other words, it is a question of their own spirituality. The joy of being a missionary, Father Ed personifies that to us, inspiringly. Jokingly, I told him now, I want to become a missionary also. How is that? And my dear brothers, there is no substitute. All our contributory items that have raised our consciousness of late, they are important. It's important, for example, that after Vatican II, it took Blessed Paul VI, the father of dialogue, the one who made very clear to us that dialogue must first be dialogue with God, dialogue with peoples and their culture, dialogue within the church, and even dialogue with nature, as Father Ed advocates. This father of dialogue, do you know what happened to him? As the one by divine providence who carried to the conclusion Vatican II, he was the one guided by the Spirit to speak about the things that would not be needed, that the documents, 16 of them by themselves, cannot do the miracle. It is the way we respond to the challenge and the insights, the gifts of the Spirit contained in those 16 conciliar documents, the reception. And that is why, remarkably, the words and the key words that we are so involved with today, 50 years after Vatican II, like evangelization and dialogue, they were both already after the council, immediately the concern of Blessed Paul VI. 50 years thereafter, we are getting busy with it, finally. But are we done with the issues? Oh no. Historians of the church have told us it will take us 100 years before we can actually measure the impacts in terms of the fruits of an ecumenical council. We are only halfway. But remarkably,
the issue of dialogue became current only 20 years ago. Although, as Father said in Ecclesiam Summum, the encyclical of Paul VI, the first one, he already mentioned that it took us 25 years before we can hear him. And in the last 20, 25, we have been active. And now finally, for Ecce of the CBCP, we have a summer institute of the topic. That is how it moves. Festina Lente. We seem to be making a lot of progress slowly. But thank God, something is happening. But how can we really fuel, how can we really implant our church to be going full blast into this? Everything moves slowly. Evangelization, we discussed that it was not Saint John Paul II who coined the word, no, it was Paul VI. John Paul II picked it up and really worked on it. But there is a beautiful component taking place right now before our very eyes, that if John Paul II emphasized proclamation, now Pope Francis is emphasizing the component that goes in tandem with proclamation, and it is dialogue. Let us take a closer look at this dialectic, this process. But first, the element that Bishop Joseph yesterday underlined, and which Father Ed also picked up again, expressing his joy that the word spirituality is used in connection with our topic, is that what Benedict XVI and John Paul II both in chorus underline, that we can only be evangelizers to the extent that we ourselves have been evangelized. That we are not concerned with something notional, with something cerebral, with something purely intellectual. That was the point of Bishop Joseph. Having been in the academic world, in Rome for 40 years, a professor, is very conscious of that. That theology as an academic exercise will never do the trick. We have to return theology to its original meaning. Not theory in terms of a proposal, in terms of conjectures, no. The original theoria in patrology is contemplative. The original theoria is the contemplation of the economia salutis. And it is something that carries you off your feet. That's the point. It is something that challenges you to the bottom, so to say, of your being. And that is my point. You deal with catechesis. You deal with catechism. The catechism of the Catholic Church said something, 221, that for me is very, very important. He said, the innermost secret of God is the mystery of the Trinity. And that the plan of God is that we, human beings, are destined to participate in it. If there is something exciting in theology, if I may add to Father Ed's moral theology and missiology, it is what we would least expect to be exciting and in movement, and it is this. One of the most abstract courses in dogmatic theology, the Trinitate. Remarkably, it took the bishops of the Universal Church 25 years after Vatican II, before really having a certain comprehensive understanding of Vatican II, before picking up what Pope the Sixth said in 64. Very strange. So, Pope the Sixth, Vatican II, 85. Extraordinary synod of the bishops coming up with the conclusion that would later fuel the doctoral thesis of Chico Tagle, that the main central legacy of Vatican II is the ecclesiology of communion. And this communion is not, in the first place, communion among us, but it is communion whose original paradigm is no other than the Most Holy Trinity. Incidentally, my doctoral candidate at UST, to be defending his doctoral thesis next week, is a priest from Indonesia, and he has written a beautiful doctoral thesis on the theology of communion and the divinization of man, Father Eddie Taxito. And that's why I'm very conscious how this, what is contained already in Vatican II, and first called to our attention by Paul the Sixth, took so many years before the Bishop Synod paid attention to it and bring our focus to it. And now, another 20 years before you start having doctoral thesis at the level of Asia by Asians, registering, so to say. But it is this communion and dialogue. It is Trinitarian. That Paul the Sixth said in Ecclesiam Summa, we must recover what he said, the transcendent origin of dialogue. The transcendent origin of dialogue. And what is that? The image of God that has been implanted in each of us is a God in an eternal exchange of love. So the word now, the first word that would give us a key into the dynamics of dialogue is the word commercio, admirabile commercio, the exchange of love between the Father and the Son, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, that eternal self-giving love of the Father to the Son, to the Father to the Son, the Spirit, Father and the Son. And it is this mystery of God, this dynamics of love that we have been told by Saint Thomas. It is Abonum, Augustine exclaimed, so ancient, ever new. That is Tempusibum Sui. It is an extra. It is now the mystery that led to the creation. And creation imprinted with God's own image among the children of God. To participate in that exchange of self-giving love. That is our destiny. That is the way. The way is Jesus Christ to participate in it. And there is something here, my dear brothers, that we have to be aware of. There is something that is syncopated in the way we present it. Please look into it in catechesis. I notice it in our hymn this morning. We said, Lord, when you come, we will see you in your glory. Is that correct? Of course that's correct. Is that complete? Of course, it's not complete. We see the plan of God that we participate in that dialogue happening within the Trinity. The dialogue, the mystery of exchange, give and to give and to receive. We see that as an spectacle, and that happens for us when we to look at it. Yesterday, when Bishop Francis de Leon mentioned Kevin Costner, yung ano yung pelikula, Dance with Wolves, the word dance. The fathers of the church captured it. Our destiny is not too much a spectacle by the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. Our destiny already in baptism is to enter into communion with the Trinity, to be part of the community, so that already now and forever later, we will be part of that perichoresis. Literally, we will dance with the Trinity. We will be moved in that dynamic movement of love, given and not received, being there for the other completely, forever and ever. It is this vision that has moved Jesus in giving us the message that we, during this Easter season, Father, I desire that they also whom Thou hast given me may be where I am. And where will he be? Where is he as risen, as glorified? Even in his humanity. Jesus glorified in his humanity is precisely in that commercial Trinitatis. That they may be where I am. That the love you have given for me before the foundation of the world will be given them. I have made known to them their name, and I will make it known that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them. The burning desire in the heart of Jesus is one. The reign of God, the kingdom of God is when we are taken up into the secret of the Trinity. That is actually the root for the euangelion, for the gospel. That is the joy of the gospel, the divine life. But we seem to have dichotomized. It is something. We live in a world of movies, of CDs, of, you know, pictures. And without noticing it, perhaps we have relegated into a super picture what is actually eternity for us, what heaven should be, and therefore what should be coloring already now our proclamation, and what should already be now defining our relationship. Religion is the relationship between God and human race. And that relationship characterized by God's initiative, revealing himself to us, talking to us, the God who speaks, is really the picture of the God who loves. Because when you speak to someone, you are sharing yourself, and you believe that someone is precious enough to be spoken to be addressed by you, to be offered yourself, and that someone is precious enough to offer you something. The God who speaks in the Old Testament speaks volumes. And that is why it is what we proclaim. That is our news, the plan of God, should already be transformative. That's it. Let us not, whether in catechesis or in homilies or in our own encounter with God, the Word of God is not just any word. It is the word of the living God, the God who takes the initiative of addressing us, inviting us, waiting for us, having something for us. That God, the God of love, is the God of the eternal exchange of life and love. Do we have that? Is that what we communicate? Number two, if we have that, is that not worth proclaiming to others? And as we proclaim that to others, then the method of God, the patience of God, the God who sent Jonah to the Ninevites, tell them the warning, give them the chance to repent, avoid the disaster. But it was misunderstood by the messenger. What he wanted was two. What God was waiting for was repentance. What God was waiting for was the chance to seek forgiveness and therefore a restoration of friendship. Sometimes we ask, why is it that we miss it? And the answer is what the Second Plenary Council of the Philippines actually put its finger on, exactly on this part. When our bishops meeting together a lifetime ago, 23 years ago, said, we dream of having a community of disciples. Community with whom? Among ourselves? No. Community with Jesus, and because community with Jesus, community with the Trinity. We who have been baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, baptized into the mystery of the Trinity, baptized into the life of the Trinity. We who have been initiated into the Trinitarian exchange of life and love, we, shaped by the Word of God, now become disciples, missionaries, sent to the world to dialogue with everybody to share that good news. Why aren't we fascinated by what we are proclaiming? Why is it for us many times shut aside because we have other priorities? St. Augustine said, you cannot set anyone on fire when you yourself are not on fire. St. Thomas said, you cannot give what you do not have. We say, there is no joy in any gospel to share, to proclaim, to spread, if you yourself haven't felt that joy in listening to God. And that is why PCP2 clearly stated that already as seminarians, formation must be focused on having these candidates for the priesthood, having a personal relationship with God in it and through His Word. So that what we have heard and what others will hear, believe what you read, preach what you believe, practice what you preach. That simply systematizing what is to be taken for granted. You yourself have heard the message. That is why it now drives you to share it, because nothing better can be shared with anyone else. And that's why you're willing to listen first so that they are ready. You're willing to be humble so that there will be no obstacle. You are willing to be forgiving. You are willing to learn from others so that in turn they will be ready to listen to what you're